evening again, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leah Genovese and I'm a member of the Lecture Committee at the SEM Society, and it is my pleasure to welcome you all tonight to this evening. Before introducing tonight's speaker, I would like to mention other talks arranged for the next few weeks. They all begin at 7 and they are held here unless otherwise stated. On the 16th of May, we have a British journalist by the name of Dominic Folder, author of a book on the life and work of Thailand's former Prime Minister and elder statesman, Anand Panirachun and the Making of Modern Thailand. On Wednesday, the 29th of May, 7 p.m, The History of Tea and Thailand's Place in Tea History, a talk by George Van Driem. This talk will be held at the Open House Bookshop, Level 6, Central Embassy Shopping Mall. So please make a note in your diaries. It's a Wednesday and not here at Central Embassy on the 6th floor. On Thursday, the 20th of June, a talk by Mr. Etienne Clément. Some of you remember that he's a very welcome speaker here, like all our speakers. He is an international lawyer who worked for UNESCO for over 30 years, and he will be discussing the restitution of cultural objects to the country of origin. It's a very thorny subject, and I think he's a very qualified person to discuss it. On Thursday, the 27th of June, we have a talk by Pasuk, Bompaichit, and Chris Baker on the many meanings of love in three Thai literary classics. And now tonight's speaker is Dr. Bruce Weniger, welcome, who has held a number of international positions in the field of public medicine, including postings to Bangladesh, Somalia, and West Africa. He is currently part-time international professor at the Research Institute for Health Sciences of Chiang Mai University, and adjunct professor, associate professor at Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. In the mid-1980s, he advised the field epidemiology training program at the Thai Ministry of Public Health and published Thailand's first comprehensive review of HIV/AIDS. In tonight's talk, Dr. Weniger traces the history of the early HIV/AIDS epidemic in Thailand and highlights of the country's key contribution to global prevention. I hope many of you can stay for the Q&A afterwards. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Bruce Weniger.
Thank you, Leah, for that introduction. It's a real honor to speak here at this august institution. I started, 1904? And I have a few disclaimers or disclosures or caveats. Many of my slides are from Kodachrome's 25 years of age. They contain some terminology that might not be any longer politically correct. So please excuse me for that. I didn't have the time to be able to convert all of those Kodachromes to modern, you know, PowerPoint graphs and whatnot. And so let us begin. And if I think of any other disclaimers or caveats, I'll mention them as we go along. Also, I won't be reading every word of every slide in the interest of time. But if you'd like to get a copy of the presentation, send me an email. These days, it's hard to keep those addresses secret with Google, or come up afterwards and we'll figure out a way to get them to you, okay? So let us begin. I have a table of contents here we'll go through. First, we'll talk about the sequential waves of spread in population groups of the HIV epidemic, some determinants and risk factors for how I feel, what encouraged HIV spread, the appearance of AIDS, and an interesting anecdote about when the very first case showed up and the societal burden, how the pattern in Thailand has spread to its Asian neighbors with similar features, some epidemiologic enigmas that I don't think are fully explained. Maybe we have experts in the audience who work today in this field. Maybe they can fill me in on the answers to these findings, and some discussion of what's happened since the early epidemic in terms of prevention efforts and their effect on the disease in Thailand and elsewhere, and the global examples that Thailand has set in that regard. So let's begin with the very first study of HIV in Thailand using test kits that were sent from CDC, the very first Abbott Laboratory test kits. And they were tested at the Sirirat Hospital of Mahidol University by Ajahn Prasert Tong Charon in the center here and Ajahn Chantapong Wasi, neither of whom were able to make it today. They're getting on in age. And basically, we looked at 600 subjects, about 100 in each group. These were the male commercial sex workers. I hope that term is still valid. In the Patpong Red Light District, female commercial sex workers at the Bangrak STD clinic, male patients at the Klung Toi STD clinic, injecting drug users at the Tanyarak Hospital, blood donors at Sirirat Hospital, and thalassemia patients at Mahidol who are frequent recipients of blood. And here's the findings that we got. Of all those 600, there was just one positive on ELISA and Western blot, a male commercial sex worker, age 20, working in a gay bar in Patpong. In later surveys in that year by AFRAMS, they found four others HIV positive in that same category. And notice the drug abusers, of 100 drug abusers, none was positive. So this was the 0% we just reported in the previous slide is here. The AFRAM 0% is over here, 85 and 86. And things went along until the Tanyarak Hospital, which was testing each and every one of 47,000 subjects in this time period who came in. You can see things went from 0% in a Bangkok Metropolitan Administration drug treatment clinic and close to that proportion, and then all of a sudden, boom, this huge and rapid onset of the epidemic starting in about early 1988 and reaching this steady state of roughly 30 to 40% positive. And this is when the national sentinel surveys began by the Ministry of Public Health over here, pretty much more in the same area. And basically, it was known in late 87 that there were a number of prisoners, some expatriates, some Thai, in Thai prisons, and there was a relatively large pardon in December, and that may be how the virus in that population of the prison seeded the community at large with the various risk behaviors that would allow it to spread so rapidly. If we look at the sentinel surveys that were done, this is the one in December 92, a few years later, among HIV among IDUs throughout Thailand, the 8th National Sentinel Survey. You can see a number of hotspots in red, Chiang Mai. This, I think, is this is Pra, I think. This is what's the name of this province? I'll think of it. Anyway, you see some hotspots, but really rather high, 20 to 30, 39%, 40 to 59%. So the virus in drug users had spread throughout the country. So this slide represents a summary of all of the surveys by the Ministry of Public Health and National Sentinel Surveys. By the time I finished making Kodachrome slides, these were basically the ones you saw in the previous slide, the IDUs. And what we see here now are all the waves of transmission that occurred in follow-up to that first explosive increase. The brothel females, commercial sex workers, the brothel-based ones, the male commercial sex workers, male STD patients, indirect female commercial sex workers, we'll talk about that in a minute, and the antenatal pregnant women patients and blood donors. So let's go in a little bit to a study that was done at Tanyarak Hospital by Twip Kittiapurn, of Mahidol University and the HIV-AIDS collaboration, in which they looked at all 47,900 patients who had had drug testing done at that hospital in this window of time, 87 to 92. It's a bit of a complicated slide. And of those, there were 7,807 who were HIV negative at the first visit on the record. And so that became a cohort for the incidence, which is reported in the left-hand slide in the solid bars. And you can see this astronomical rate of incidence in IDUs, over 50 cases per 100 person years. You can think of it as like over 50% in a period of time, a unit of time. That's what incident is. Incidence is new infections in some interval of time. And that's in contrast to prevalence, which is on the right-hand side with the dotted lines. That's just a snapshot. At a single point in time, you find 100 or 1,000 people, test them, and what's the percent positive among the total you tested? And it illustrates an important point that even though we saw on the previous slides and here that the overall prevalence in both the pure IDU drug users and the ones who had both used drugs by needle and syringe as well as by other routes, it was fairly steady. The red is the IDU users only, and the yellow is IDU mixed with those taking drugs by other routes. So you would think, gee, there's no problem, but you can see the incidence rates were still over 10 or 5 to 10, indicating the epidemic was constantly happening. So you can see that prevalence can give you a false picture because there's a constantly changing population. People are dropping out from the population because they're either dying or stopping using drugs, and new ones are coming in and getting reinfected. So it's an interesting epidemiological teaching tool. The next category with the brothel-based commercial sex workers, which are distinguished from what we call the indirect ones, and we'll get to that now. So this is a typical brothel or tea house employing direct commercial sex workers in Shanghai province, where CDC and the Ministry of Public Health established a research site to study and evaluate prevention methods in these women. And this is, for example, condoms with customers. So here's the same nurse here talking to the women, and this is the teaching materials for how to use condoms with their clients. And another survey this category of commercial sex workers was done in December 1990 by the Ministry of Public Health, and these are the results graphed by the UN. And you can see the black color is over 40% prevalence in these provinces. So we have Chiang Rai and Lamphun and Rayong, and I think this is the one that has the truck stop on the way up to Korat. And so 40% Patum Thani, Samut Sakhon, Rayong, Upper North, Chiang Rai, and Lamphun. So just remarkably high rates of infection. Turning now to the male commercial sex workers, whom you would think would be one of the earliest groups to get infected, but it turns out they weren't. We have them tested, both men tested as commercial sex workers, and those who just have STDs going to a clinic, probably not necessarily professional sex workers. And then that issue or that phenomenon of AIDS getting in or HIV getting into the male population is very nicely documented in this data from the Thai Army, which I believe is the best reflection of the national young male population. Why? Because they had huge samples. Every year they conscript a fairly large proportion of the Thai male population age 21. For example, 19,000, 30,000, 24,000, 31,000, 30,000, and they test a sample of them for HIV. These are the numbers that were actually sampled for HIV. But what's important about it is that except for those who at the upper socioeconomic levels who escape the draft either by exemptions or deferments or whatnot, it's probably 80 to 85% of the Thai male population age 21, and you can see how the rate of infection went from 0.5% to 1.7 to 2.1 to 2.9 to 3% in the space of 89 to 91, just roughly 2 years. Just a remarkable explosion in that group. And then finally we come to the antenatal patients, what I call the wave number 5. I forgot to mention the numbers I've assigned to them. Well, when you have so many men infected, they're going to start giving the virus to their wives or their girlfriends, and that's what these antenatal patients represent. These are basically women going to public clinics for antenatal care. So the ones who are going to Bumrungrat and Samitdhuway and fancy private hospitals would not be in this data, but they're the ones going to community and provincial and regional public hospitals. And the sixth wave after that, of course, if you have a lot of pregnant women, let's go back to the numbers here. So roughly it was about 2%. I think later on we'll have a slide with more exact details. By 92, roughly 2% of all, most women in Thailand in this population subgroup were HIV positive. And when you have HIV positive mothers, you're going to get HIV positive newborns. And this is data from Professor Wirat at Chiang Mai University of the symptomatic children admitted to that hospital for the first time, going from 2 in 89 to 17 in 2000 and peaking in this period from 92 to 96. Just a remarkable increase. Let's now turn to what I consider some of the determinants and risk factors for HIV spread that explained what was going on in Thailand. First, for injecting drug users, there clearly was widespread sharing of unsterile needle syringes. Another factor that was determined is that the more time you spent in prison or having any history of being in prison, increased your risk of being HIV positive because drugs are often available and needle sharing occurs in prisons. And Michael Martin just sent me a paper, came out last month showing how they documented this in some cohort studies that they did. Also, there are secular trends. During that era, they were clamping down on the narcotics trade and pushing the opiate refineries up towards the Golden Triangle because it's a lot easier to transport small quantities of heroin than larger quantities of opium. So the opiate refineries moved closer to the poppy fields, and as the drugs were smuggled, drug users began injecting heroin newly available instead of smoking opium. Now let's turn to sexual transmission and what I consider some of the determinants. First is the traditional double standard in that era. It may not exist anymore for sexual behavior between men and women. Substantial proportions of men engaged in sex with smaller numbers of female commercial sex workers. Most women were abstinent before marriage and monogamous afterward. And modeling done by Roy Anderson and others shows how if a small population of commercial sex workers, they can easily acquire HIV from their customers and other STDs as well, and then increases the probability of transmitting back to their non-infected clients. Another feature is circumcision. I think it's fairly likely that female-to-male transmission is less likely than the other way around. You know, once your foreskin is removed, what used to be mucous membrane is gone and your skin becomes keratinized with a layer of dead cells called the squamous layer, which is harder for the virus to penetrate. And interestingly, epidemiologic, and you'll see this soon, HIV seems to spread faster where circumcision is uncommon, like Thailand, Myanmar, Cambodia, Vietnam, India. And the spread of the epidemic, despite having virus documented, has been much, much slower in countries where circumcision is common because of religion, either Muslim or Catholic, Indonesia, Philippines, Bangladesh, Brunei. So here's a slide. Well, we'll get to that in a minute. The other trends in sexual transmission that I think influenced the epidemic is that in this era, there was widespread industrialization throughout Thailand and elsewhere in Asia, which was drawing young men and women from rural areas to factory towns. So marriage was often delayed, and there was increasing premarital sex in these factory towns and dormitories for the factory workers, you know, from young people far away from the normative influence of their families in their village. Another feature was the economic liberalization in China, Vietnam, and Cambodia, where communism was basically abandoned for capitalism, and it revived this entrepreneurial spirit in which commercial sex flourished, or reflourished, if you will, with increases in HIV and other STDs after commercial sex had been suppressed for many decades. So I talked earlier about the double standard. And it wouldn't surprise me if it's quite different now. But this is a study done by Wereset Sittitrai et al., the Thai Red Cross, in 1992. And look at the differences here, males and females. Median age at first intercourse, 18 over 20. Sex among the never married, 25%, 1.6%. Premarital sex among the ever married, 64%, 1%. Mean number premarital sex partners, 30, 0. Extramarital sex in the last 12 months, 17%, 0.2%. Paid another for sex in the last 12 months, 22%, 0.1%. Received pay for sex in the last 12 months, 1.6%, 0.8%. Visited prostitutes ever, 43% of 1,000 vocational students, 64% of 311 rural men in Tak province, 75% of 600 randomly selected in the Bangkok and regions. I can't remember what the noun was here. Randomly selected somebody, must have been males. Yeah, it's the same red color. 78% of urban men in Tak, 97% of conscripts in the northern region. Visited prostitutes in the last 6 months, 16% of 600 randomly selected males. So clearly different what's going on today. Maybe there's some social scientists here who can fill us in. Going back to circumcision, this is a chart or a graph that was made by UNAIDS, WHO, and the London School, showing 80% prevalence of circumcision in countries with a lot of Muslim or Islamic influence, Indonesia, of course, Malaysia, Madagascar. North America and Australia are more or less 20 to 80%, and less than 20% Thailand and much of the rest of Asia. So that, some people feel, is an explanation. Whoops, did we go, we touched the wrong button. Okay. Of why Thailand faced a more difficult situation because so few men are circumcised. Now, obviously, that's not going to affect male transmission to females, but it might reduce the likelihood of female bouncing back the infection to the male partner. Let's talk just briefly about AIDS and the societal burden, since I think we all know how severe it was. In 1984, the Division of Epidemiology received a phone call from Dr. Anawat Limsuan at Ramatipiti Hospital, reporting the first AIDS case in Thailand. And this was already 84, several years after the epidemic had become recognized in the U.S. and elsewhere. And about 10 epidemiologists, including from the FETP, Field Epidemiology Training Program officers, got into a van and drove a couple of kilometers to the Ramatipiti and surrounded this young man, who had been a college student in Louisiana, in the United States. He was diagnosed there and he returned home essentially to die. And I didn't have a photograph of this, but people were quietly standing around his bed, including Dr. Anawat, questioning him about his illness and his diagnosis and his risk factors. And it was the first case reported to the country in Thailand. And this is the graph that was made in 92, because the scale is so tall to accommodate over 1,000 cases in males and females by 92. You can't see the numbers. So this is the patient one here. There was one case here, too tiny to be even see on this graph. There were 7 males in 87, 2 males in 88, 3 females. In 89, there were a combination of 29, both males and females, 56. So it went from 5, jumped to 29, jumped to 56, and then we're roughly about basically 300 or so here, and here we're over 1,000 if you add the males and females together. So a rapid increase, as you might expect, with virus having come into the country sometime in this prior period. And this is a graph from the Ministry of Public Health. I've added the common era years to the Buddhist era years. So it starts in 84 to 93. About 10,000 reported cases of AIDS and about 2,500 deaths in that year. And you can see things peaked as far as AIDS, reported AIDS cases, which is probably greatly underreported from what was truly happening. Roughly 30,000 a year from late 1990s to the mid-2000s. And the deaths were peaking at about 10,000 per year reported. Who knows how many were dying, and it was never reported for various reasons of shame and whatnot. So now let's talk about how this pattern we saw in Thailand, going from one wave to another, the first wave drug users, then commercial sex workers, females, then males, either sex workers or otherwise, then the general male population, then the wives and girlfriends, and then the newborns, how this pattern was thus seen fairly soon after that in neighbors in Thailand. And in that era, around 1988, Jonathan Mann and others had written about three epidemiologic patterns. In blue, we had what they were calling pattern one. The risk groups were mostly homosexual men and drug users in North America, South America, and Europe. And the sex ratio, far more men than women involved with HIV or AIDS. And then there was a pattern two. Risk groups were mostly heterosexuals, transfusion recipients, newborns. Sex ratio, men were about equal to women in much of sub-Saharan Africa. And this great Asian landmass was considered pattern three, almost no cases or just a few cases, mostly imported, limited spread, or sort of a miscellaneous, nothing happening yet. And this is a poster of a presentation that Dr. Prasert and others from India and Burma and China and I put together for a conference in Pattaya. I think Mike Benenson is here. He might have been at this conference. On how the pattern we saw in Thailand was spreading to its neighbors. So these are old Kodachromes that I didn't try to reproduce again. This, you've pretty much seen the Thailand summary in the previous slides in this lecture. We had the rapid spread starting in 1988 among drug users, and then waves of infection in brothel-based prostitutes shown here. You've seen all these slides in full color. Before, a third wave in heterosexual men, a fourth wave in antenatal women, and so forth. So what about Myanmar? Basically, rapid increasing seroprevalence was found in drug users in 1989. Here's drug users are in purple over here. You can see 89, 1990. We had to cut the scale off because this goes up to over 60 and 70% here. The highest rates of HIV were found in areas along the eastern border near China, Laos, and Thailand. I use this orange triangle to represent the famous golden triangle where the three countries meet. Okay, I won't go into all these details. You can get them if you get this, I send you the slides. So here's just one a graph showing what you saw in a smaller version in the previous slide. HIV seroprevalence in IDUs in Myanmar, 85 to 89, about 18%. In 1990, jumped up to 60%. In 1991, up to 75%. And this is the Bangkok Post on July 8, 1992. Obviously, there's a lot of informal migration among all these countries. Burmese women were coming in either voluntarily or tricked in some kind of sexual trafficking roles. And here the police are arresting them and sending them back to Burma. So you can see how easily virus can spread among these countries. Let's talk now about China. Through 1991, there were about 705 persons identified in China who were IDUs living near the border with Myanmar. And this is Yunnan province, and this is the town of Ruili, which nowadays is a major port of entry between China and Burma for transportation of goods in both directions. And in 1990, 80% of a survey of 64 needle-sharing IDUs were HIV positive. Heroin seizures in Yunnan province rose from 120 kilograms to 270 kilograms from 88 to 90, as the smuggling from the Golden Triangle increased into China. And here's a graph, not of HIV, but of just the proportion of drug users who told the surveyors that they were using injection to acquire their drugs. In 83, basically zero. By 1990, over 30%. And this is the Bangkok Post again, June 1992. In December 1992, China arrests prostitutes. Prostitution makes a comeback in Shanghai. This is the economic liberalization that China was undergoing under, Deng Xiaoping. What about India? The part of India that borders Burma is over here. Manipur and Nagaland in 1990, there was an explosive increase in HIV infection among an estimated 15 to 20,000 IDUs with peak age at 20 to 24. You can't really see this very well. This is, I'm not sure I can read it, 1990, I believe, July, August, close to 0%, maybe 1 or 2%, bumps up to over 50%. I have to go closer to the slide to see it. Well, you'll get it. You can zoom in when I send it to you. So, just remarkable increases. In June, in Pune, India, we're on the other side of India, HIV and STD patients rose from 8% in late 1991 to 17% in early 1992. And the epicenters of the heterosexual epidemic in India at that time were the coastal huge conurbations, a bit like Bangkok, Bombay, and Madras. Where's Madras down here? Okay. And here's the some HIV data for Madras. So what about northeast India, which was bordering the northern part of Myanmar? Here's July 80, I guess this is the data I was trying to read from that previous slide. Roughly about 2% July 86 to September 89. October 89 to June 1990, over 50% seropositive. 1991 down a little bit, or about 45%. Now we hypothesized, how did this virus get into Thailand and spread by the use of polymerase chain reaction, which allows us to actually do genetic analyses and compare the genetic makeup of and subtype and categorize different subtypes or so-called clades of HIV. And we'll talk about it in a minute, but basically two subtypes came into Thailand. There was B, which may very well have come from Europe or North America, was the predominant one in homosexual risk groups in Europe and North America. But E, which later on became called cross-reacting AE, I believe, probably came from Central African Republic, where it was previously found. Got into Thailand, and then it started spreading to China and all over the place. This is a slide that's in a review of molecular epidemiology that was published some time ago. And here you see this line, this curvy line of E going to Japan. This is a flyer that you'll often see, at least in that era, in telephone booths or fall into the sidewalk in Japan, advertising prostitution, 30 minutes for 2,700 yen. Thai AIDS strain found in the Japanese. This is again Bangkok Post 1992. Experts, Thai HIV strain likely in Japan. So we're seeing evidence of how this virus spread. And this was a slide from 1994. Of reported HIV infections. It was sort of vague at that time what was actually being reported. Was it AIDS cases or HIV infections? But you can see Thailand had 14,000 reported AIDS cases, but estimates were there might have been 840,000 in the country. And if you look at the numbers in all these other countries, rather small, except Australia probably had pretty good reporting, 18,000. But still, Thailand had the largest number, probably because of the excellent reporting and surveillance system of the ministry, as well as the willingness to make it public, and I suspect many of these other countries were trying to suppress the numbers for various reasons. So now let's turn to the two epidemiologic enigmas that I don't yet understand and see if people have some theories in the discussion. Using the ability to subtype HIV strains, there was a subtype we called B, which is the same B they used to call it in North America and Europe, which was basically predominant in the drug users. These are the pies showing the pink is the subtype B, and the E, or the now known as AE, cross-reacting AE, is the proportion that had that virus. In various studies, this is 93, 94, 93. Just look at this remarkable difference between subtype E, originally we called it Thai genotype, serotype A, and then subtype B, which was the same terminology used around the rest of the world. How do you explain this? So some hypotheses or speculations are, was it due to a genetic founder effect, that the first virus that gets into a population just takes over and overwhelms any ones that arrive later? It predominates. And also, maybe there's just very little interaction. The drug users were not having sex with the prostitutes to give them the strains that they had. Other hypotheses are that there are biological differences between the HIV strains. Maybe these different strains can result with exactly the same type of patient with different quantities of infectious virus in their bodily fluids that transmit the disease to others. Thus, they may have differing eases of transmissibility depending on which strain you have. And they may also affect the speed of disease progression, so you get to high virus loads in your bloodstream and your bodily fluids at an earlier point in your infection. Who knows? Maybe the answers are out there. I just don't know them. Another enigma is, why is the upper north of the northern region of Thailand, such a hot spot for sexual transmission compared to other regions. It's seen on numerous studies. I didn't give you the data, but the sentinel surveys, the CSWs in northern Thailand are always higher than everywhere else. The male STD patients always have higher rates of HIV infection. Pregnant women in the public antenatal care clinics were always higher in these provinces up here. And the army data, which I'm not showing, when they stratified by region, the conscripts from the upper north had the highest rates. Why? Well, I don't know, greater frequency of commercial sex acts maybe in that part of the country. Maybe there's a smaller pool of commercial sex workers serving a larger pool of clients, so it more quickly spreads the virus. Maybe there are other cofactors like STDs that are more common up here that might explain why HIV was spreading more quickly than elsewhere. Maybe also the sort of the longevity of female sex workers working in the business before they leave to do other work means that they have a longer period of time to become infected than pass the infection back to uninfected clients. Finally, let's cover some of the research and prevention efforts that I'm not as knowledgeable about, I'm sure, as many here in the audience, but I'll do my best. In that era, there was in the early 1990s, a National AIDS Committee was started. The Prime Minister chaired it, so this was a very high-level committee. All the ministries were tasked to get involved in doing things about AIDS, and there were major public education efforts. Laboratory diagnosis was strengthened. The Ministry of Public Health and other groups were doing surveillance and publishing the results, which I think was very helpful to marshal the resources against the epidemic, because when you suppress the data and hide it, people don't think it's worth investing money to solve it. And as an example of this, the Thai budget was the equivalent of US $700,000 for all this work in 1988, and it bumped up to $7 million by 1991. So as an example of this AIDS education effort, the famous Michai Viravatia was appointed to head a education effort in the government. I think the Prime Minister was maybe Anand Panarachan, is that right? But I can't remember. He was building upon his years of famously promoting family planning with condoms. And interestingly, his first name in Thailand, Michai, is synonymous with condom. And it's sort of ironic because condom itself is the last name of a British guy who invented the device, I don't know, 100 years ago or more. And so here is Michai promoting his prevention method. Now, many of the early public education efforts were what I call fear-based. And this photo is of the AIDS devil in the waiting room at the Shanghai Regional Hospital. This is me with a little more hair of a different color, Jim Curran, the head of CDC AIDS at the time, Dr. Wat Uttaiwaravit, who is a senior person in that hospital, the AIDS devil, Helene Gale, who was my immediate boss, and Dr. Kanchit Nabakarnjanarat, the co-director with me of the HIV-AIDS collaboration at that time. And my feeling, my feeling is that this type of fear-based behavior change efforts are not really effective, and it's probably too early for anything you do to change behavior until patients begin to know people with AIDS who die. They know the guy across the street, they know the cousin, they know the son, and so once the disease becomes personal to you in terms of knowing people, whether famous movie stars or family or friends, all the knowledge is out there. You have the knowledge, but it doesn't change the behavior. And another feature of Thailand's AIDS prevention program was pioneered by Dr. Wiwat Rochanapitayakorn, who was an MOPH medical officer in Ratburi. And he started this program that they called the 100% Condom-Only Campaign. He got the health officials and the police to work with the brothel owners and their employees, the commercial sex workers, to insist that the condoms must be used by the clients. They'd put up signs in front, if you don't use a condom, don't come to this establishment. They'd distribute free condoms. They had peer educators who would, you know, encourage the women to become superstars, and they'd have model brothel dedication, sort of like, you know, AAA recommendation, this brothel. And if STDs occurred at the clinic where the women or their clients showed up and they said, where did you have sex, you know, a week or two ago? then the police would crack down on that and give a warning to the brothel owner, if you don't clean up your act and make 100% condom compliance, you will get in trouble. Whoops. And Dr. Wewat was actually awarded the famous Mahidon Prize, a famous prize in Asia for his work. They also verified that the condom uses were going up. They would do searches of the trash cans at the end of the night and see if and count the number of used devices they could find, and not a very pleasant job. But they also would have health workers or students in some provinces. They would go in as customers, pretend they were customers, and find out if the women would insist on condom usage if the customer said, "I didn't want to use it." Whether they actually went through beyond that point, I don't know. But you can see the rate of sex acts with condoms as measured in this Ministry of Health and Hannenberg et al. Berlin conference paper, about 15% in 1989, bumping up to over 80% in 91. And over the years, this is a more recent photograph I took. There's so many modern prevention and well-funded efforts have been implemented. This is a Stop TB and AIDS through RRTR STAR project, and this is just an example of the huge amounts of health education going on. And this is a brochure I picked up at some conference a couple of years ago. Very hip, very slick, safe sex. This says here, a new generation of women look out for their health, and it's showing exactly how you open the condom bag and put it on and so forth. What I found amazing is it had the Ministry of Public Health logo. In my era, you would never see something so upfront and risque with a government logo on it. So that's certainly a change from the early epidemic. Also, in terms of prevention of mother-to-child transmission, major clinical trials were conducted in Thailand. I think the CDC MLPH project was involved. There may have been other university activities doing the same thing, proving that giving pregnant women who are HIV positive anti-HIV drugs during pregnancy and or at delivery protected the newborns from infection. Not 100%, but it reduced it two-thirds in those newborns, and it became a national policy to give those drugs to pregnant women who are known to be HIV positive. Also, there was universal provision of AIDS treatment drugs. Thailand, at a certain point, disallowed drug patents on AIDS drugs to lower their cost, which is permitted under World Trade Organization rules for public health emergencies, and the government pharmaceutical organization actually made some AIDS drugs. I misspelled this one here, too. And imports other drugs in bulk if they can't make it here, and then they package it and sell it locally at a good price. And the famous Samsip Bot 30 Bot National Health Security Office program, sort of like Medicare or Medicaid, covers all AIDS patients with these drugs. So there should be no economic barrier to getting these drugs to treat you once you have HIV, or to take a drug if you're engaging in risky behavior to prevent your infection. Finally, in terms of prevention, the world's largest HIV vaccine trial was held in Thailand, in Rayong and Chonburi, and was the first to show some protection. They had 16,000 subjects, 8,000 got two experimental HIV vaccines together, 8,000 got placebo injections. In other words, some other valuable drug injection, it might have been hepatitis B, that would be helpful to them, but was functioned as a placebo compared to getting the HIV vaccine. And the period ran from 2003 to 2009. Huge numbers of authors here, and it's downloadable for free even if you don't subscribe to the New England Journal at their website. In the first year, overall, they had a 31% reduction in new HIV infections, which is a good start. And in the first year, it was actually 60%, but then it sort of waned over time. So that was a remarkable achievement. And now there are all sorts of follow-up studies, also called RV. This trial was called RV, what was it? I can't remember. RV? What? RV144. In fact, interestingly, they don't even mention that, even though everyone uses that term. This entire article never mentions once the RV designation, but now there are like a bunch of sons of RV studies going on today. Now, that's been a depressing subject of how bad things got in the early part of the epidemic. So my next few slides are going to show some reason for optimism, how things finally got a little better. You may recall that the incidence rates in drug users we were showing you was roughly 10% in the years from early 1990s. And this is a paper that Michael Martin just sent me, published last month, on incidence in drug users, in other words, rates per 100 person years, dropping from 5 down to roughly 2% per units of time from 1995 to 2012. So great progress. What about sexual transmission? I've had to increase the size of the labels because they're hard to read, but this is the IDUs that for some reason seem to be going up and then finally peaked. This is like 1989 to 2004. It sort of peaked over here at 50% and going down. The red ones are the women working in brothels. It peaks roughly around 94, and then starts dropping down to less than 10% by 2004, remarkable improvement. The indirect commercial sex workers working in bars and nightclubs and making private, freelancer deals with their clients went from zero up to roughly 10%, but dropping. And the male STD patients at clinics peaking in, once again, the mid-94s and dropping by 2004 to about 5%. So progress, improvement. These are in the diamonds, brothel CSWs going in 1996 from 25 to 30% prevalence down to roughly 5. The same for indirect CSWs starting around 10% and going down to about 2 or 3%. Male STD clinic patients starting about 8%, 7% and going down to the same area. This is from the Bureau of Epidemiology, Ministry of Public Health. These are the conscripts. You saw how that earlier codogram going way up and still sitting up at the top. They peaked around 93, and now the prevalence rate of new conscripts coming in is roughly, where are we, five, basically two, 2.5%. There's a 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, so about 1.5% by 1999. So great improvement. These are two different populations mixed on one slide from AFRMS. We have the 21-year-old military conscript. You just saw this data. It's hard to see the years. I think this is 18. What year is this? Can you read this? Anyone read? 89. So peaking around 93. I think it's the same data on the previous slide. And these are pediatric AIDS cases in Thailand, but I can't remember exactly how they found them. It's going from one quarter of 1% around here, peaking around 3.5 to 4% and dropping down to... Wait, we have different scales here. I don't know what this scale is. Oh, but anyway, they're down to about less than 1%. These are the women in the public antenatal clinics. They peaked around 94, 95, and now they're down to about 1% by 2004. Now it's quite a few years since 2004, but I haven't seen the data on them, and that was beyond the scope of my talk. Whoops. The blood donors peaked around 92, and now they're down to about 0.25% in 2004. Pregnant women at the antenatal clinics, this is similar data as before, 96, 1.8 to 2%, going down to about 0.5%, 0.6% in 2014. So this is much more recent. And so 96 to 2014. And these are VD cases. I don't think they call it VD anymore. They call it STDs, sexually transmitted diseases. In Thailand, 1982 to 92, you can see how gonorrhea peaked around 86 and then dropped way down as all those condoms were being used to close to 1%. Nonspecific urethritis, sort of the similar peak but more blunted, going down to less than 1%. Chancroid dropping, everything sort of dropping as you're using condoms more often. This is STIs, sexually transmitted infections, another euphemism for, or a new term for VD. Reported at government clinics, 85 to 96. You can see how the numbers are dropping. I think it's more, maybe more or less the same data as the previous slide. So remarkable to go down so much. I can't figure out what the, oh, these are total cases in thousands. So these are, less than 0.5% or less, or maybe two. I can't do the arithmetic. Okay. This is AIDS deaths in Thailand. Source UN AIDS estimates 40,000 a year in 2005, dropping. Of course, there's a long tail with so many people infected and living with AIDS to about 20,000 in 2013. So remarkable drops. It's like they say that when the epidemiologist arrives at the epidemic, he usually arrives after the peak and it's going down, he can claim the credit for it. Now, in most scientific presentations, there's a credit slide with lots of names of all the institutions, and there are probably hundreds, maybe thousands of people throughout Thailand who are involved with HIV in that early era, doing surveillance, laboratory work, clinical care, and so forth. So I can't picture all of them, but I pictured some of the leading leaders in that area. These are the FETP medical officers, many of whom surrounded that patient at Ramatipity Hospital in 1984. Dr. Wewat, whose picture you saw won the Maridong Prize, is here. Dr. Conchit is here. And Dr. Wasson is, raise your hand, Dr. Wasson, he's over here. There. And this is the HIV-AIDS collaboration, whose name is now the Thailand Ministry of Public Health, the US CDC collaboration. They call it the TUC. These are early staff and children around 1990 here. And Dr. Bundi had a kit. I didn't have a picture of her. I couldn't find her in here, so she's also here. Raise your hand, Dr. Bundi. This is her here, still as beautiful as ever. Okay. And so with that, I thank you, and I think hopefully there's time for Q&A. And so I welcome that. We can. Thank you. Can we turn the lights up so we can see each other? Okay. Do you want me to just take questions or what? You have something to say?
Thank you, Dr. Weniger. Now we've got a couple of mics going around, but I have a question for you, if I may. I have a number of questions. In Thailand, absolute numbers of HIV infections have fallen. But in March this year, so about 6 weeks ago, the Department of Disease Control, Ministry of Public Health, reported that half of all new HIV infections today are among young people, especially students and young employees. The report also mentioned that the most common route of HIV transmission among young people is unprotected sex. So we have moved from IUD and so on to now youngsters being at risk. And the thing that struck me, that correct me if I'm wrong, or anybody in this room, is that in Thailand, you cannot go for an HIV test without parental consent unless you are 18 or older. Is that right?
I wouldn't know the answer to that. I'm sure someone in the audience might. Anyone care to answer whether you need
it? It's actually not correct. You can receive an HIV test without parental consent. The Thai Medical Advisory Board recommended that this occur. So at least in our clinic, we provide HIV testing without parental consent, and there's many other settings that do. The one area that's controversial is treatment. So for treatment, it is many folks need parental consent for treatment, is my understanding. Yeah. So.
I didn't know about the news report that you described, but it doesn't surprise me. And if I can take the time for a little anecdote, back in when I was an EIS officer in parasitic diseases, every 3 or 4 days we would be the officer to receive the call to request pentamidine, which was a limited drug only the CDC had, from doctors around the country who had patients with pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, which turned out to be one of those opportunistic infections that when people with AIDS lose their immune systems, they become susceptible to this very rare disease. And I remember we used to have a little pink form. We'd take the doctor's name and the patient's name and age and whatnot and where the hospital was so we could have the nearest quarantine station, use Delta Dash, like the DHL FedEx of that era, to send the drug immediately. And we'd ask them, we had checkoff boxes, why did the patient have pneumocystis carinii? Did they have cancer? Were they taking steroids? Did they have some other known immunosuppression? And they say, no, the patient doesn't have any of those. And I would just fill out unknown, other. And I didn't think anything about it. And I turned it in to Sandy Ford, who was the clerk and responsible for that. And after a couple of weeks, she started to notice all these requests for pentamidine coming in with patients with no underlying condition to explain why they got this disease. And it was she who figured it out and told Mike Schultz something's going on here, and that led to the realization that there was a problem out there. So it just goes to show you've got to have a high index of suspicion that something's going on when it doesn't fit. Don't just put it in the box and let her take care. You know, we would call the quarantine station immediately in the middle of the night and then turn in the form, but she was the one who put all those forms together from the different medical officers involved. So my thought is that having lived through the epidemic, we saw how in the beginning so many people died of HIV or got AIDS and died, and then people started to change their behavior in the United States and Europe. And they started practicing safe sex and doing other things to limit their exposure or to prevent themselves if they weren't positive from infecting their sexual partners. But those people eventually grow old, and there are always new people joining these risk groups, whether it's drug users or people having multiple sexual partners. They have to keep relearning the lesson. So when people in their 20s finally learned the lesson, eventually they became 30 and 40 years old and they were practicing safe sex, but then there are new young people who are joining these risk groups and engaging in risky behavior. You have to continually deal with young people who are starting to engage in risky practices to make sure they don't, and they practice safe sex and safe injection or whatever. So it's, you can't just do it once and figure out that it's, you've got to constantly deal with young people who are starting out in life. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm very curious these initial HIV infections, because I'm kind of new here, you know, doing HIV work. And with these initial, the first HIV case that seemed to, it was acquired in the U.S., but there was also a first case that was acquired in Thailand.
Yeah.
What do you think happened there? Was it already occurring and it was just detected first, or was that a case one here in Thailand, or something else?
Well, the patient from Louisiana was a Thai. I can't remember how many years he had been in Louisiana studying. And he obviously might have been infected 3 years, 4 years, 5 years before he came down with AIDS. I mean, there's a long asymptomatic period after you become infected until you start showing symptoms. In that era, in 84, later in 84, I think there were two cases, and I've just read the article from 85 reporting on the serial survey I started the talk with, that I think there were like five patients with AIDS, two of them Thais, the one from Louisiana who came home, and one who had never left the country. And so this was 85, 86. Who knows when that patient got infected? It might have been 4, 5, 6 years earlier, you know. So the virus had been here for a while. We didn't pick it up till the Abbott test kits arrived in 85, but it was probably circulating in maybe 1980 or 81. I mean, I don't know. I can't recall when people feel in the U.S. the virus was circulating with that so-called, patient zero? Is that what they called it? I can't remember when that was. Clearly, with a long asymptomatic period, which is what the problem is, because they're passing the infection on even though they're perfectly healthy. There's a long interval between when people get infected and when they come down with AIDS. Any comments or any corrections of things that I said that those working more up to date than I am might fill in? Yes. Is there a microphone?
Thank you. That was an amazing summary of 20 years or so. You gave us one slide which showed comparative figures in countries around Thailand. Uh-huh. I forget which year it was, but Thailand had about 14,000 or so, and they were only in the hundreds mostly.
Maybe we can go back and find it, yes.
And you said that that was perhaps because other countries were suppressing the data.
Right.
But is there another interpretation that actually, because Thailand had such a large tourism industry, it was a much more, in a sense, open society in terms of human movement. That's the one. Was Thailand, in a sense, country one for the region? Because in some ways,
it's hard to say, because I think, and I'm going to be immodest to say that Thailand was unique because at that point in time, the Ministry of Health had something called the Field Epidemiology Training Program with WHO's financial support and CDC support, which was modeled after the Epidemic Intelligence Service of the CDC, which is involved with epidemics in the US and all over the world. So they already had in place probably more sophisticated surveillance system. They were publishing a weekly epidemiological surveillance report, sending it all over the country. When reports would come in, they would often send out officers to the province to help them. So they were encouraging reporting from the provinces, because the provinces would get this report back showing how the data actually got used and summarized and epidemics. So Thailand, I think, was unique in having a more sophisticated and extensive public surveillance system where they emphasized feedback. So they would encourage reporting because the people down in the provinces and wherever would see that if they send in reports, they would actually, the data might be used and they'd see the report come back. It was like a weekly epidemiological surveillance report of CDC. In fact, they still publish it today. So I can't remember exactly where this data came from. Obviously, it's quite a few years ago. And I think in some of these countries, I'm not sure whether they're reporting. Here I say 41 cases of AIDS. Here it's Pakistan, 120-somethings. By this time, of course, HIV testing was available. So I can't say, but clearly Australia's, you know, in the category of, and I think Thailand, where you can rely on these reported numbers. And what's interesting is Australia had roughly about the same number of AIDS cases. So to get back to your question, did I answer it, or can you repeat it?
No, it was just that you suggested that the other countries were either suppressing the data or right. You just said that they didn't have the measurement options available, yeah. But you also said that maybe they were suppressing the information.
Well, I think that happens, I think, all over the world. For example, when cholera occurs in Thailand, there are periods of time when nobody wants to report it to WHO because it is an internationally required reportable disease, because it's going to affect exports of seafood from Thailand, it's going to affect a lot of things. So they'll call it, you know, severe diarrhea, and they'll work it up, but it won't get sent to WHO. So I think this happens, and it may continue to happen. I can't say. So now that I don't work for the government or affiliated, I can speak with a little more candor about those kind of things. I see Eileen is smiling. Do you have a comment? She still works for the government, so she's...
Have you, in those early days of the epidemic, have you ever had instances like we've recently seen 2 years or 3 years ago in Cambodia with traditional health practitioners using unsafe needles and contributing to a kind of outbreak investigation? And has that ever happened in Thailand, or did you?
Well,
be interested to hear any anecdotal stories about that.
I can't recall hearing about specific cases, but it wouldn't surprise me. It happens in America. I mean, we have every so often there'll be clinics where they're not properly disposing of needles and they're reusing them, or they're thinking if they change the needle but use the same syringe on multiple patients, that's okay. Well, it's really not okay, because some blood can go retrograde back into the syringe. So it wouldn't surprise me. I'm sure it happens all over the world, and it's probably still happening in countries that can't afford to replace needles and syringes, or they're still using glass ones that need sterilization, and they don't bother for whatever reason. They can't afford the fuel for the fire. They can't afford this. They can't afford that. I'm sure it's happened in Thailand as everywhere else, including in the U.S. and Europe. Maybe not to the same frequency, though. I see Dr. Siraporn, former director of the National Children's Hospital. Do you have any thoughts about HIV and your experiences during the last 20 years with the epidemic? Can we use the microphone? Okay.
Actually, I'm not the infectious. I'm a pediatrician, but I'm faced the early era of HIV in my institute, and it's like a very discriminative reaction to the patient. I still have the bad picture of the HIV patient, but right now I know that the intrauterine transfer from mother to the children is very low compared to my period, about 25 or 30 mm-hmm. years ago. I'm already Thai.
Okay, I'm not going to let you go yet, because one issue I didn't bring up, I think I might have mentioned on a bullet that I didn't speak about, is how to prevent HIV-positive mothers from transmitting HIV to breastfeeding children. And Dr. Siraporn is a world-known promoter of breastfeeding. How did Thailand deal with this issue of, I mean, everyone thinks breastfeeding is like apple pie and motherhood, but how did Thailand deal with children whose mothers were HIV positive and they needed to be fed milk?
We not use breastfeeding for the HIV, the case that have the HIV. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you just gave them formula?
Yes, and we will not get the formula for free because mm-hmm. we have to protect for the code of marketing also.
Yeah.
So the government will pay for the formula.
Right. They don't allow infant formula into hospitals. They don't allow the formula companies to give it for free to the parents because it seems it would make the parents or the mother think that the hospital was endorsing this product. Right. So Thailand's been very good in that respect. Yes.
Just an anecdote as well. You mentioned the studies. There were actually two supported studies. One was here in Thailand. The other one was in Abidjan, Cote d'Ivoire. And the Thai team beat us in Cote d'Ivoire because we had lingering effects of the breastfeeding. We could not convince our mothers in the study to give up breastfeeding. Whereas the Thai investigators, 100% of their enrolled women were stopped breastfeeding, and so they had a much more higher efficacy than the Abidjan team in Cote d'Ivoire.
Yes, yes. I think doctors in Thailand get far more respect from their patients and from nurses than the doctors in my country and elsewhere. Yes, so when the doctor says something, people sometimes usually comply. Yes, another question up front here.
Yes, I'll be probably oversimplistic, but you have described a period of time when basically being diagnosed for AIDS, HIV, was a death sentence. And nowadays you take your daily pill, a triplet, Envoya, whatever, and you become undetectable and you lead a normal life for many years to come and it's not a constant fear in your life. And my question is, what is the situation in Thailand right now? Do people still die or is the medical cover efficient?
Well, I'm going to ask one of the experts still working in HIV and AIDS today in Thailand. I'm sure there are still deaths because we have people who were infected 20 years ago and the drugs are not 100% effective and maybe they don't take them or for whatever reasons. I'm sure there are still deaths. I think we showed 2014, was it, an estimate of, was it 10,000 deaths a year? But, you know, that's going back many, many decades to when they got infected. But is there anyone working in AIDS today that would care to answer the question of how many they estimate are dying of AIDS today, roughly? We won't hold you to it. We won't quote you.
I think there is what's often referred to as the cascades, the national cascades, the 90% knowing their status, 90% on treatment, and 90% viral load suppressed. Thailand has done very well for the identifying the people that, with HIV. It's about 95 to 96%. It's still a little bit lagging about the second 90. It's only, I believe, 79% of the ones diagnosed that are actually on treatment. And then there's also still some work to do about the viral load testing and the viral load suppression. And so reasons for why people dropping off on treatment are a little bit unknown, or there's issues with the different insurance schemes or the place of residence and going back to their place where they're actually registered, etc. So that's, and then of course you also have some resistance. But with the current regimens, and there's this new regimen that still needs to be registered in Thailand, the TLD, what they're referred to, it's a very effective regimen. And if they people adhere to and take their pills regularly, there should be a high efficacious regimen and should be good.
Is it fair if I ask a question back? Is it true that one can say that in Thailand, if you know you're infected with HIV, if you want to get treatment, you can. Even if you're extremely poor, you could always find a way. Maybe you have to travel 600 miles to your home province because the local hospital doesn't have responsibility. But is it fair to say that if you have HIV, you can get treated with the best drugs available by the government? Is that a fair conclusion, with caveats maybe?
Yes.
Fair statement.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
I was just going to add to what Terry said, which is while the cascade numbers are quite good for overall number of PLHIV, you do see less progress across the cascade with men who have sex with men and with transgender populations. So there's still major challenges with stigma or lack of access to health care for those populations, which are still the key drivers of the epidemic.
And this may relate to my suggestion earlier that you don't change your behavior until you personally know people who are dying or very sick. And so each generation has to learn that lesson again and again. People are constantly engaging in these practices, but they may not yet know their friends or relatives of that age who are dying. So it's sort of a need for constant continuing education. Do you want to wrap things up, Liz?
Dr. Weniger, thank you so much. It's always useful to go back and revisit the early history of something.
Should we go into the light here?
Thank you so much.
This is Sung Bat Siam, the science.